Yo.
What's up? This is Patrick.
Hey, and this is Bob. I just did a yo. This is Bob Ward. Hey, Patrick, what's going on, man?
Bob, welcome to Gynae Cube. Today, Bob's going to show us how to bring SQL Server into the Microsoft Fabric. What? Okay, Bob, before we get into all this stuff and you talk about all the sequels and stuff like that, why don't you tell people who you are and what you do?
Hey, Patrick, thanks. Thanks so much for having me on the show. You guys are so famous, and I feel pretty honored to be here. So I'm an architect in the Azure data team, and I work on everything that's called SQL at Microsoft Edge to Cloud. So, and Patrick, this is crazy, but this is my 30th year at Microsoft. So I've all been working on SQL technology back to diskettes.
What's a diskette, Bob? I kid. I think I started working with SQL Server back with SQL Server 2000 or 7.0 or something like that, long time ago. And you know Power BI is my favorite thing. Power BI is my favorite Well, let me back up. Since it's folded into the Fabric, the Microsoft Fabric has become my favorite thing. And you're telling me you're going to bring SQL to the Fabric.
I know Power BI is your jam, and it's not mine, but I wanted to find a way to use Power BI to analyze SQL data, but the data exists in the Fabric, and I figured out how to do that. First of all, it starts with the fact that SQL 2022 supports a concept called data virtualization and something called CTAS.
You know we're Power BI people over here. We do DAX and Power Queries. What is this CTAS thing you're talking about? The CTAS, what is that?
Create External Table as Select.
All right. It's a mouthful. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Patrick, you know what a partition table is, right? Like you take your data, you partition it, typically horizontally, like on date ranges or something. If the data gets older or colder, they'll switch the partition out of the main table into what's called an archive table. That way, they can help manage their cold data in a different way. So this archive table is just a SQL Server table. You can call it whatever you want, but there's a concept called partition switch. This is where CTOS comes in. So what I could do is take this create external table as select statement that SQL now supports in T-SQL, run it against my archive table, and say, I'd like the result of that to be parquet. And I can take the target and put that in Azure storage. Now, when I query this CTOS table and do a select from it, SQL really goes to Azure storage to parquet and then gets the result and brings it back. So it's a way of actually archiving cold data, but then accessing data just like it was a SQL table.
Okay, Bob. So you know how we like to do a Gynae Cube. Enough of all this talking. Let's head over to your laptop and see how this works. Yeah.
So here I've got a SQL Server 2022 system, and I've set up like a database with like sales data. Here at the top, you can see this idea of what's called a partition function. And the partition function concept is a way for you to partition out your data, however you want to do that, however you want to slice it out.
Got it.
And in this particular example, what I'm going to do is just use like date ranges. And that allows me to switch out a colder partition of data. Now what I'm going to do is show you this CTOS stuff. So the first thing I'm going to do is create an external data source, all based on T-SQL, and that's going to point to my Azure storage account with my credentials. And then I'm going to set up a definition of a file format, but we recognize Parquet automatically. So here's the switch. I'll switch this older partition, the cold data, into a SQL table. It's like exporting to a SQL table. And then here's the CTOS statement to say, create this external table in Parquet in Azure storage based on my archive table. So here's the thing. Now you just run a select statement against this CTOS thing. So when that select statement's running, SQL is really going to the cloud and getting the Parquet, which we can do like column elimination if we want to, and we'll pull the results back or even union that cold data with hot data. And let me flip over here to the portal. Here's my Parquet data. So anytime I access that external table, I'm really going after Parquet, which of course is cheaper storage for the data. So it's a way of just getting my cold data into a different data source.
Just to make sure I understand this, you're taking some data out of the SQL table using your switch function and you're writing it to a Parquet file in the blob storage. But the beautiful part for me is you can query it. You can query this Parquet file with native T-SQL. But where I'm confused, Bob, you made a promise at the beginning. You told me you were going to bring this archive data over to the Fabric, and it's just in blob storage. I don't see it in the Fabric.
Since the data's now in Azure storage, Patrick, what I discovered is the Fabric team has something interesting called a shortcut in OneLake.
Oh, yeah.
So I can go into the Fabric now and create a shortcut that points to my Parquet data, and I can do whatever I want with that. But potentially, because of the OneLake concept, the shortcuts, I can even maybe go through some like analysis of data even in Excel. And I started journeying around the experience myself. And I told myself what I'd like to do is run some analysis with Power BI in the Fabric against my archived sales data, which is now in Azure storage, Parquet, and like an Excel survey. So I want to combine these together all in the Fabric story. So in the Fabric Explorer, I'm going to create a shortcut to my Azure storage account. This is the same URL where I archive the Parquet data. I give it credentials. Yeah. I'm going to give it like a name so that inside this Explorer concept inside the Lakehouse, I can then see this Azure storage data as kind of like a shortcut. So here's the container name where that data exists. I'll hit create. And then now in my Lakehouse, I can kind of navigate this data, and the data still lives in Parquet. So looking over here, I can say, oh yeah, that's the same Parquet file I had in Azure storage. What do I do now? I don't know about you, but I kind of like the concept of notebooks. So in that same Fabric Explorer already, I can use like a PySpark notebook and build it inside the Fabric interface here. And I can go visualize this Parquet data directly where it lives inside Azure storage. The interface to build my notebook editor is right here actually in my browser, or my Fabric Explorer browser, which is really nice. And then I can go here in Parquet and get the path to it, because it's not in the Fabric itself. The data doesn't exist in the Fabric. So I can go here, put the path in, and run my PySpark notebook. And this is just a basic one. I can do whatever I want with Spark, right? And PySpark. But this is just to kind of visualize what looks like in Parquet.
Wow.
So already,
wow.
Data that's already been archived from SQL in the Fabric, I can already do some analysis with a notebook.
That's pretty cool. But can you do something with Power BI with this data?
I could, but what I really learned as far as doing Power BI is I need to put this in a table. What I found in the Fabric is the Fabric supports a concept called the Delta table. And what I didn't realize as I'm going through this Explorer concept is I can go to my Parquet file itself and I can say, hey, I want to load that as a Delta table. So I click on here and say, load the Delta table. Maybe you've seen this before. Yeah. And I'll just give it a name that makes sense towards this sales month of data, the month and the year. And when I do this, the Fabric is going to take Parquet, put it in this Delta table format now. By doing that, I can easily just kind of browse and look at the table itself with the column names, the types, even visualize the data. But do you see at the top of there, this new Power BI data set? That's what I want to go do. I want to go build a Power BI data set on this, and I need to put in this Delta table to do that. To me, what would be more interesting is that if I could integrate this together with other types of data. Yeah, let's say an analyst in my company had done Excel, and he had sentiment survey data stored in a spreadsheet associated with the customers I just showed you with their sales data. And the surveys align with those months of the archived sales data. So how do I put that inside the Fabric? Well, I was kind of spelunking around and I discovered this jewel of a feature called OneLake Drive. On my laptop, I can actually take my spreadsheet, drag and drop it into this OneLake Drive in my Windows Explorer. And then in the Fabric, I can refresh this thing and boom, there's my CSV file. And I can even load that as a Delta table. So now I'm down this journey where this is all now in Delta.
The next time you do that, when you open up that OneLake Explorer, you want to say, it's the OneDrive for data. It's the OneDrive for data, Bob. It's the OneDrive for data.
In my laptop, I can just treat it like a OneDrive and just drag and drop data. And it shows up here in the Fabric. It's just super cool, right? I've watched you guys present on Power BI before. Not much, but some.
Yeah.
And one thing you guys have taught me is how to properly model things. What I want to do is I want to establish a relationship between the sentiment data and the sales data. So what I discovered is in this Lakehouse Explorer, I can actually change to something called like a SQL endpoint. If you look at the top right hand corner, see you have see Lakehouse up at the top up here. But what I can do is I can go up here at the top and instead I can pick a SQL endpoint, and that's going to allow me to do some stuff like do modeling of the relationship between my data. Now the view changes a little bit. It's showing my tables. When I click on model, I can just drag and drop the customer because that's the relationship between the two tables. That's the key. I can drag and drop these and define and say, hey, this is my relationship. And what you guys have taught me before when I've seen you present is if I have this relationship now, I can do very powerful things in Power BI, like build a data set and then do reporting based on the relationships in these data sets. I went back up here and I thought, what would Patrick and Adam do? I'm like, okay, we'll go to new Power BI data set. And by the way, I want Power BI to automatically create something here. I don't want to build a report like you guys. So once I have this data set built like this, what I didn't realize is I love this visualized data auto-create report. When I viewed it, initially it wasn't exactly what I wanted, but it got me started. And by clicking on a couple of fields, I got this. I love this. If you're an analyst now, you could go click, and you guys show this all the time to folks. You could click on any kind of given bar in the chart, and then the rest of the data pivots with it. So if I click on this customer, I can see the data highlighted for my sentiment information. So any customer sales information, I can make some kind of make trend analysis. So I was able to easily combine all this data very quickly in the Fabric, but I started on the journey just by archiving my cold data from SQL into Azure Storage.
Yeah. All the time you were working with the Fabric, that you brought the data in, you created the short cut, you did all the things. You went into the notebook, which wasn't necessary. You just did that to take a look at your data. But to get to the point of creating the report, how much code did you write?
Zero. I didn't write a single line of code. That's crazy, right?
Wow. Is this not bananas? If you want to learn more about shortcuts, be sure to go out and watch the video that we got on our YouTube channel. If you have any questions, comments, and you want to chat with Bob and myself, you know what to do. Post it in the comments below. As always, from Adam,
Bob,
and myself, thanks for watching. We'll see you in the next video.
Yo.